anybody? I'd like to repeat what Lila said a couple of weeks ago. We Central New Yorkers do like our four seasons, and here we are experiencing them in 1 week again. But it is what it is. Let's celebrate all of God's creation as it is, and enjoy and celebrate. Welcome to worship at the United Church of Fayetteville. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace.
Thank you.
Please join me in the call to worship. With crowds from ancient times, we cry, Hosanna, save us. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. Endures forever. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Bless you in the house of the Lord. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Let us worship the living God. Let us join together in prayer. We praise you, O God, for your redemption of the world through Jesus Christ, who entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Let these branches be signs of his victory and grant that we who carry them may follow him in the way of the cross, that dying and rising with him, we may enter your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let's put our palms to good use. Confess before God our tendency, like the Jerusalem crowds, to profess our faith in moments of enthusiasm and deny our faith in moments of fear and stress. Let us say our confession together. Merciful God, as we enter this holy week of Lent, solemnly gathered at your house of prayer, may we turn our hearts toward Jerusalem. We want to walk the way with Jesus, to be present each step from the Mount of Olives to the cross to the empty tomb. And yet we fall away. Forgive our stubborn resistance to Christ's work and witness. Inspire us by your Spirit to follow his way until we enter with him into the city, not made by human hands, the new Jerusalem, eternal in the heavens. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The one who rode into Jerusalem to cheering crowds knew that the cross awaited. In this way, we might know the great love of God for us. Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, has defeated sin forever. Hear and believe this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Hear these words from the Hebrew scriptures reading from Psalm 118. The translation we're using is The Message by Eugene Peterson. Thank God because he's good, because his love never quits. Tell the world, Israel, his love never quits. I didn't die, I lived, and now I'm telling the world what God did. God tested me. She pushed me hard, but she didn't hand me over to death. Swing wide the city gates, the righteous gates. I'll walk right through and thank God. This temple gate belongs to God, so the victors can enter and praise. Thank you for responding to me. You've truly become my salvation. The stone the masons discarded as flawed is now the capstone. This is God's work. We rub our eyes. We can hardly believe it. This is the very day God acted. Let's celebrate and be festive. Salvation now, God. Salvation now. Oh, yes, God. A free and full life. Blessed are you who enter in God's name from God's house. We bless you. God is God. They bathed us in light. Adorn the shrine with garlands. Hang colored banners above the altar. You're my God. And I thank you. Oh my God, I lift high your praise. Thank God, she's so good. Her love never quits. Please be seated. You know, it's bad when the choir walks out and I haven't even started. The gospel lesson from today is from Mark's gospel, the 11th chapter, and that's not what they're walking out on. When they were nearing Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany on Mount Olives, Jesus sent off two of the disciples with instructions. Go to the village across from you, and as soon as you enter, you'll find a colt tethered, one that has not yet been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone asks, what are you doing? Say, the master needs him and will return him right away. They went and found a colt tied to a door at the street corner and untied it. Some of those standing there said, what are you doing untying this colt? The disciples replied exactly as Jesus had instructed them, and the people let them alone. They brought the colt to Jesus, spread their coats on it, and Jesus mounted. The people gave him a wonderful welcome, some throwing their coats on the street, others spreading out rushes as they cut that they had cut in the fields, running ahead and following after. They were calling out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in God's name. Bless the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Jesus entered Jerusalem, then entered the temple. He looked around, taking it all in. But by now, it was too late. So he went back to Bethany with the 12. These are the words of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we ask that you would open our hearts, our minds, and our souls to your word for us this day. We ask that you would open our lives to your word for us this day and every day. This prayer we offer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is indeed the Word, the Light, the Way, and the Truth. Amen. So I don't know about you, but I'm pretty old. So my understanding of Palm Sunday has shifted over time. So I started out doing the whole waving palms, learning the fine art of cross-making. Right? Singing in the choir. And then as I got older, my focus shifted and my brother and I competed as acolytes in the Episcopal Church, seeing who could light the candles the fastest. Because that was really far more interesting than anything that was said in church at that time to me. As a young adult, in college, I went to Catholic Mass because that was the time on the weekend when I had a fighting chance of not having a headache. And I could actually hear the meditation given by the priest, who was really cool and wore sunglasses in church, as if he was afraid the brightness of the gospel would blind him. Or maybe he was just trying to be cool. And he was accompanied by guitarists and these really good-looking musicians, singing non-traditional hymns that were never sung in Episcopal churches, which is what I grew up in, and challenging us to really think about Scripture and our lives. And then I worked in Manhattan, near the Battery, traveling in by rickety train, then underground through the Twin Towers before they fell, which tells you how old I am. And I worked in banking, which was a complete and total mismatch. And as I rode in, I was such a nerd. So I had on the woven seats that we rode on in the old train lines at that point, a Bible and commentaries and a script from a play I was helping my sister and her high school friends put on at their Presbyterian church. And I was immersed and in love with the commentaries and the scriptures. I grew up in the time of Jesus Christ Superstar and Godspell, and perhaps some of you have heard of this one, the Cotton Patch Gospels, based on the writings of Clarence Jordan. With a healthy background in classical requiems and their more modern interpretation. But seminary, learning biblical languages, reading historic and archaeological writers, traveling to Israel and Jordan, having intense conversations with friends, and becoming slightly more disciplined in prayer and worship, my mind was overwhelmed because Palm Sunday was so much more than any one of those experiences I had had in my lifetime, so much more even than the culmination of those experiences, so much more than anything I could imagine. And I'm pretty sure I still am only touching the surface. In Mark's gospel, we're introduced very quickly to the central conflict between God's kingdom, God's vision of the world, God's created, dreamt, hoped for possibility, and the empires. At that time, it was Rome, and then throughout the centuries, different countries have led this sort of imperial process, but you'll notice that Rome's patterns and the patterns of empires since then have continued much the same. Two different visions, two different parades that enter Jerusalem on that Passover day. And we are called to choose to put our feet where we think we belong. So from the west, Pilate came, in with troops full of imperial glory, described by John Dominic Crossan and Marcus Borg, two historians and scholars. They write, a visual panoply of imperial power, cavalry on horses, foot soldiers, leather armor, helmets, weapons, banners, golden eagles on poles, sun glinting on metal and gold. Think about the sound echoing through the narrow city. Overwhelming, clanking, marching, a clear vision of the Pax Romana, a peace enforced by those who grew rich off that peace, by those who controlled who had a voice in government and deciding who received taxes and who didn't, by those who owned the land and were in charge of where money went, by those who led the religious institution and benefited it as well, and so supported Rome. On the opposite side of the city, Jesus comes. A planned, we can tell this from Mark, from the fact that half of the story we read today was all about getting the colt. Right? A planned, nonviolent counter-demonstration. Instead of swords, we see palm branches. Instead of military gear, we see cloaks laid down, fulfilling Zechariah's prophecy of a king riding a colt who heralds the end of the empire and the reign of God's peace. Jesus marches in, and the rest of Zechariah's prophecy is held out as a possibility, where the chariots are destroyed, where the swords become plowshares, as Isaiah would say, where the weapons of war are destroyed. Hosanna is a cry for deliverance. Save me. Help me. Deliver me from Rome. The crowd uses the coats on the road to call up coronations of past kings and the branches to remember the Maccabees and other rebellions. They proclaim Jesus as the long-expected heir to David, who will overthrow Rome and usher in a new golden era of Israel's power, something they long for after centuries of being controlled by other kingdoms. And Jesus not only challenges empire, but also the crowd's expectation. For his vision, God's kingdom is a peaceful one. Not only where there is no violence, no military enforcement and death penalties and torture, but one where there is abundance. Goods and resources are distributed so that all have enough. Imagine how that good news sounds to the crowds gathered around. hoping for a return to glory, to the disciples hoping to be part of the new ruling elite. Yet they are stopped in their tracks too. Jesus processes through the sheep gate in the east. There's lots of gates in Jerusalem, and each one had a particular purpose. This particular gate was where the sheep came in for the sacrifice on Passover. A direct challenge to the religious leaders, asking them to look once again, to re-examine the choices they've been making, their loyalty, their way of supporting themselves, their understanding of the Hebrew Scriptures, to tear down the walls that separate the different courts in the temples, the court of the Gentiles, the court of the women, the court of the men, to welcome all into God's presence regardless of their economic resources, regardless of their ethnicity, regardless of their gender, regardless of any other human attempt at separation, and return to those prophetic scriptures, to those foundational scriptures of creation that are affirmed as good, as welcoming, as places where all of creation celebrate. Jesus successfully changes things for everyone. Everyone is uncomfortable. The sign of a good, successful, nonviolent protest. No one feels quite right at the end. And they're all afraid. They're all angry. They're confused. They're threatened. And some might even be feeling pretty self-righteous. But they all have a choice to make. Which parade will they march in? Which parade will they join? Will they move toward conflict in a search for peace or away? Will they extend abundance to all or keep most of it for themselves? Will they turn away from the hammer wielded by the Maccabees in their rebellion or the sword wielded by the soldiers from Rome? And turn to the Lamb of God or not? These choices, these practices, these experiences are what Jesus calls us to at the beginning of this Holy Week and every Holy Week. Whether we are children waving palms or making crosses, whether we are lighting or not lighting candles, whether we are winning in competition or working together in cooperation, Jesus calls us to choose. And each of those choices is one step forward. One step. Just one. Right foot, left foot. Just one little step toward the kingdom that God has promised. A kingdom of peace. A kingdom where all finally remember and live as God's beloved children in that community where there is enough for everyone. May it be so. Hosanna. Amen.
Consider what you carry in your hands today. Do you carry the rein of a donkey, a cloak to share, a branch to wave? What do you bring to welcome the Lord today? Whether you share your gifts today as the plates are passed online or through the mail, trust that the Lord needs you. Prayer of dedication. Let us pray. As the crowds cry, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We are truly grateful for the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ our Lord. Receive these gifts as a symbol of the dedication of our very selves to you, O God. Use our gifts and use us as part of the inbreaking of your kingdom, which comes and is still coming into our world today. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask that you would open our eyes to the needs of the world around us. As we enter into Holy Week, we are especially mindful of the needs of our brothers and sisters in Gaza and in Israel, throughout the Middle East. We are also mindful of those in countries around us that are torn by violence and by starvation, remembering our brothers and sisters in Haiti, in Cuba, in the Ukraine and Russia. We remember our brothers and sisters in the Sudan and also in Gaza who are starving. We remember those who have been struck by natural disasters in countries that we have not seen. We ask that you would open our hearts to the needs of people we have not met, with whom we may share no language and no experience, but with whom we share our identity, that we are all created as children of God. And so we ask that you would guide us to choose wisely. Gracious God, we pray also for our nation. We are on the lead up to another contentious election where we have, for some, very difficult choices to make. We ask that you would strengthen us that we might turn and see our neighbors, that we might take the time to listen to one another, that we might reach out to the very real needs that are around us. Strengthen us that we too might choose wisely for our children and our grandchildren and generations to come. Loving God, you have heard some of our needs this morning. Our brothers and sisters who can only join us online or during the week, those who are far away from us, and all who are gathered here, new friends and old. Hear our hearts. Hear the places that we feel alone, abandoned, or confused. We ask that you would remind us that we are part of your beloved community. We are part of this family, if only for a moment, but we are part of the larger family of love that you have entrusted to us. Grant us the wisdom to choose love, to choose the ways that bring peace, that provide abundance not only to ourselves, but to all who are in need. This prayer we offer in the name of your Son, who answered our cries for salvation with his very life and taught us to practice by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. It's time to talk about our congregational mission and ministry, and the first thing I'm sure you noticed, for those of you who actually got a bulletin, is that we, like our friends who are Baptist and Presbyterian, Methodist, Congregationalist, all joined together for one great hour of sharing in our separate denominations, supporting ministries of hunger, ministries of disaster relief, and ministries that help those who often are directly impacted by poverty try out and experiment with solutions to change the world. And so if you have an opportunity and you have the resources that you can share, please consider contributing to One Great Hour of Sharing today. If you filled up your fish bank, very exciting. Austin's one out of three, just saying. So there's one in there. He's got two more to do. He's a little behind. We'll be having our basket out for those of you who managed to bring them in today and are still bringing them in. We are glad to receive your contributions. Thank you. You'll also see that in your bulletin, if you were able to receive it, we've continued our adult independence study. This is on Psalm 118. And so you'll find the front and back directions for that. And because the practice there is one of planting, you get an early Easter gift. And if you come next week, you get a second. So multiple planting opportunities, but these are these very fun seed sheets that you put in the dirt, water, and woohoo. They say woohoo. Just be prepared. I don't want you surprised. So we also have our continued sheets for children. Please take these home to your children, your grandchildren, your neighbors, pretty much anybody who likes to color. So we have coloring sheets for the different psalms that are read, as well as some March activities, and the ongoing calendar is still there. So that's pretty much all the handouts we have, because who doesn't love a good handout? But bonus, we all got palms of some sort, right? I think there were enough. Were there enough? There's more probably around. Apparently, if you weren't here last year, you didn't receive the memo, but you wave your palms at the first song. I didn't know. Was that a spontaneous waving, or just because I didn't have the handshake? It was very fun, very, very fun. For those who want the palm cross tutorial, come and see me after church. I'm happy to help you out with that. We have the formal one that has a YouTube video with it and looks all professional. And then we have the just put it together and it'll stay one too. So we have several options. We are going to, immediately following this service, record our Good Friday service. Or is it immediately? Are we going to eat first? Okay, first we're going to go to coffee hour and refresh ourselves. Then we're going to change gears, and at least I'm coming, and Sarah and the choir and John are coming in here to record Good Friday, and Bob is going to make sure that actually records. And you all are welcome to stay if you have time. We'd love to have some more folk. If not, that's okay too, but for those who would like to see the service, it will be broadcast on the live stream starting at noon on Friday and extending through Saturday. On Thursday, we celebrate Maundy Thursday together, and we gather together here at 7 o'clock. Following that, if you would like, you are welcome to participate and be involved in a prayer vigil, and there's a sign-up sheet right out here in the narthex, and I hope that you'll sign up. The key issue for us is if you don't have a church key, which I understand is kind of like the secret handshake, right? Pretty much anybody who's come more than once, so Nolan, just a heads up, you're going to get a key pretty soon. So anybody who comes more than once, there's a good chance someone has given you a church key, and now you're official, and they've taught you the secret handshake. And so we want to make sure anyone staying for the vigil is safe and the doors are locked, however. So if we have any gaps, that's why we ask for your name and your phone number as well, so that we can organize those gaps and make sure folks can keep their vigil and be safe. We'll be setting up in the Beard Lounge because that has a separate heating space so we can keep you toasty. But you don't have to be toasty. You can, because we live in Syracuse and you are tough. You can have your vigil in the sanctuary. Just bundle up, wear your layers, and that will be fine too. I think, did I get them all, John? I think I got them all. Did I get them all? Any other announcements that I missed other than that you need to be ushers? Right, Mary Jane? Okay, any other announcements? Just checking. Going once, going twice, as John would say, and we are moving on to our final hymn, number 237. As we enter Holy Week, may we have the courage and the faith to wait and to walk, to listen and to pray, to plan and to be surprised by the plan of the Lord that leads to life. And as we go to invite others to join us in this most sacred way, may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit draw near to us and carry us this day and each day to come. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God.